This is a snapshot of the COVID-19 case fatality rates by age group in China reported on February 17, 2020. The larger bars on the right reflect the fact that the elderly generally have a higher risk of death when contracting COVID-19. These orange bars indicate the COVID-19 case fatality rates in Italy reported on March 9, 2020. For every age group, the case fatality rates in Italy were lower than those in China. So which country do you think had a higher total case fatality rate? Surprisingly, it was Italy. This reversal of trends when separate datasets are aggregated is a statistical phenomenon known as Simpson's paradox. It's important because when it occurs, the same dataset can be used to prove two opposing arguments. Case fatality rate is the most commonly discussed measure of the risk of dying from COVID-19. It's the number of people who have died from the disease divided by the total number of people diagnosed with the disease. For simplicity, let's repartition China and Italy's datasets into two groups, below 70 and 70 and above. As before, for all age groups, the case fatality rates in Italy are lower than those in China, while the total case fatality rate in Italy is higher than that in China. But important information is hidden when looking only at case fatality rates. We don't know the sizes of the groups, and in this case, if we look at the proportion of confirmed cases by age group, we find a much larger proportion of Italy's cases were among the higher risk elderly group. How this actually reverses the trend is best illustrated using a two-dimensional vector space. The horizontal axis corresponds to the number of people diagnosed with COVID-19, and the vertical axis corresponds to the number of people who have died from COVID-19. For the below 70 group in Italy, we get that vector, whose slope corresponds to the group's case fatality rate, and whose magnitude is proportional to the group's size. For the 70 and above group in Italy, we get that vector, and for the combined group in Italy, we get that vector, which is the sum of the other two vectors. The slope of this vector corresponds to the total case fatality rate in Italy. Notice that the slope of this vector can change when the slopes of the component vectors change, or when the magnitudes of the component vectors change. In other words, the total case fatality rate depends not only on each subgroup's case fatality rate, but also on each subgroup's size. So when we compare the vectors for Italy with the vectors for China, we see that for the below 70 group, Italy's vector has a lesser slope. And for the 70 and above group, Italy's vector again has an ever so slightly lesser slope. But for the combined group, Italy's vector has a greater slope. And this is because the component vectors for each subgroup have different magnitudes, and the larger vectors dominate the overall comparison. What we were missing when looking only at case fatality rates is that the age groups in China and Italy have different sizes, in part because China and Italy have very different demographics. If we look at the age demographics of the general population for Italy and China, we find that Italy has a much older population, so you would expect it to have a larger share of confirmed cases among the elderly. And in this case, having a larger group size for the groups at highest risk resulted in the trend reversing when the separated data sets were aggregated. So, does demographics completely account for the difference in case fatality rates between both countries? No. Demographics is just one of many factors. Other possibly important factors that may be different between countries are housing and care conditions for the elderly, healthcare systems, levels of infection control and preparedness, testing practices, discrepancies in reporting, time of calculation, and more. Proper interpretation of case fatality rates is best done by an epidemiologist. And I'm not one. This example of Simpson's paradox is using real-world data. But was anybody actually using these data to compare Italy and China? Or did the researchers who identified this example have to carefully select datasets in order to demonstrate Simpson's paradox? In this specific case, I don't know. It may be the latter. But Simpson's paradox is often encountered in real-world social science and medical science statistics. Perhaps the best-known real-world example of Simpson's paradox occurred in 1973, when school officials at the University of California, Berkeley, feared that they might get sued for gender discrimination over graduate school admissions. Far fewer women applied than men, which I'll discuss in a few minutes, but the concern was that the acceptance rate of men was higher than that of women, and the difference was so large that it was unlikely to be due to chance. But when they scrutinized the data, looking at it on a per-department basis, they came to the opposite conclusion, that there was a small but statistically significant bias in favor of women. How they came to this opposite conclusion can best be understood by looking at a scattergram of the proportion of applicants that were women, plotted against the proportion of applicants that were admitted. Each box in this plot corresponds to a different department. Departments with higher acceptance rates, in a sense the departments that are easier to enter, like mechanical engineering, are positioned higher in this plot. And departments with lower acceptance rates, like English, are positioned lower in this plot. Departments which had more female applicants are positioned in the right of this plot, and departments which had more male applicants are positioned in the left of this plot. There were 85 departments considered in this study, each department having a different number of applicants indicated by the size of the box. So the smaller the box, the fewer the applicants, except for the departments with fewer than 40 applicants, which were all given a box of this size. And if we fit a trend line to this data, we see that the trend line is sloped downwards, indicating that women tended to apply to competitive departments which had lower admission rates, whereas men tended to apply to less competitive departments which had higher admission rates. And this inhomogeneous distribution explains the trend reversal that was observed when the separated datasets were aggregated. And when this one factor was taken into account, they concluded that women had a higher than expected acceptance rate. Therefore, there was a bias in favor of women. But expectations are only a valid measure of bias if all factors are considered. Recall that far fewer women applied than men, and that's in part because women faced social and educational barriers which men did not. So it may be reasonable to expect that the pool of women who applied, those who overcame those barriers, was objectively better than the pool of men. But if so, by how much? This dataset is just not enough information to properly guide our expectations and allow us to make conclusions about the presence or lack of a bias. Let me conclude with an analogy taken from the original paper on this UC Berkeley sex bias case. While it's an oversimplification of this complicated issue, it does a good job at illustrating Simpson's paradox. Picture a fishnet with two different mesh sizes. A school of fish, all of identical size, swim toward the net and seek to pass. The female fish all try to get through the small mesh, while the male fish all try to get through the large mesh. On the other side of the net, all the fish are male. The mesh did not discriminate. The reason for the disproportionate amount of male fish on the other side was that the fish were not homogeneously distributed. Simpson's paradox is a veridical paradox. It produces a result that at first appears absurd, but is demonstrated to be true nonetheless. It is a useful reminder that data are not always objective, so we must always ask ourselves if we are getting the complete story. If you like this video, click that like button. If you like paradoxes, check out my channel, and thanks for watching.